Created in 1957, the Ramon Magsaysay Award continues to give recognition to pioneers, leaders, and trailblazers in their communities and countries. This year, five individuals and a foundation received the prestigious award. From India, Harish Hande, a young engineer from Bangalore, led the way in providing much-needed electricity in households in India. Trained in energy engineering and with a doctorate from the University of Massachusetts, he established the Solar Electric Light Company India in Bangalore in 1995. Selco's principal product offerings were solar PV lighting systems, water heating systems, and cooking stoves to meet the needs of the rural poor. Hande and Selco have shown that indeed, the poor can afford sustainable technologies and maintain them, and that social ventures can be run as successful commercial entities. To date, Selco has reached more than 500,000 people by installing solar lights in 120,000 households, micro-enterprises, and community facilities. Another 2011 awardee is from India. Nilima Mishra was born to a middle-class family in the village of Bahadurpur, Maharashtra. With a master's degree in clinical psychology, Nilima was sensitive to the crippling poverty in her village. 5 years after finishing her studies in 1995, Nilima returned to her village to organize Bhagini Nivedita Gramin Vigyan Niketan, or BNGVN, or Sister Nivedita Rural Science Center. Starting with a self-help group of only 14 women, other self-help groups followed, engaging in microcredit and such income-generating activities as the production of food products and distinctive export-quality kilts. In less than 10 years, BNGVN has formed 1,800 self-help groups in 200 villages across Maharashtra. From Indonesia, Hasanayin Juwaini trailblazed in Islamic education. Indonesia is world's largest Muslim country, and there, Hasanayin established a peasant trend in 1996. A young and progressive Muslim cleric, Hasanayin opened his own peasant trend after completing his university studies and decided to open a girls' school. Starting with 50 girls, he evolved a learner-centered program aimed at developing each student's full potential. Now a peasant trend of 500 students and 60 teachers, Hasanayin School offers a government-accredited 5-year secondary education program. In his combined roles as cleric, teacher, community worker, and social entrepreneur, Hasanayin is a living example of the kind of education he preaches. Again from Indonesia, Tri Mumpuni leads a battle to turn Indonesia's vast reserves of sustainable energy into power. Born in Semarang, Central Java, Mumpuni earned a degree in social economics and immersed herself in rural development work. In 1993, with her husband, Mumpuni formed People-Centered Business and Economic Institute with the Indonesian acronym IBEKA. As a non-government organization, IBEKA committed itself to developing micro-hydropower systems for impoverished rural communities. Skill, creativity, and determination have turned IBEKA into an outstanding Indonesian example of social entrepreneurship and cast Mumpuni as a much-admired and influential leader in the field of community-based renewable energy. From its base in Subang, West Java, IBEKA has built 60 micro-hydropower plants, providing electricity to 500,000 people in rural Indonesia. It has also organized electric cooperatives, trained villagers in technical management and resource conservation, and provided support in fund facilitation and income-generating activities. From Cambodia, Kol Pana is one of the few who have bravely stepped up to the challenge of claiming the electoral process as their own and protecting it as an instrument for building a democracy. An engineer, Cole knows firsthand what brutalities are possible in the absence of a true democracy. He was 8 years old when his father and relatives were killed by the Khmer Rouge. The indescribable trauma impelled him to dedicate himself to changing his society. He finished his university degree, taught in Phnom Penh, and was already involved in the human rights movement even in the time of the dictatorship. When Cambodia embarked on its first free elections in 1993, he joined the nonpartisan Task force on Cambodian elections and was one of the organizers when this task force became the Committee for Free and Fair Elections, or COMFREL, in 1997. Under Cole's leadership, COMFREL has become the country's leading independent organization on electoral issues. It aggressively campaigns for responsible voting and electoral reforms using all available media to build a homeland that is democratic and free. From the Philippines, a small nonprofit organization in Negros Occidental has been building technology to serve the poor. For the past 15 years, the Alternative Indigenous Development Foundation Incorporated tackles the problem of rural poverty by designing, fabricating, and promoting environment-friendly technology, which is accessible and income-augmenting for the poor. Born after the collapse of the sugar industry in the 80s, AIDFI was formed to address the basic needs of the affected farmers, focusing on agricultural production and technology development. AIDFI's first success came when it redesigned an ancient and largely abandoned technology called the ram pump. In introducing the ram pump system to upland communities that do not have easy access to water, AIDFI technicians are able to provide clean, cheap water for household use, livestock raising, aquaculture, and small-scale agriculture. AIDFI continues to innovate on technology for the poor. To increase rural incomes, AIDFI has designed and fabricated an essential oil distiller that can process lemongrass into organic oil for industrial users. AIDFI has also established a technopark to showcase and demonstrate AIDFI-designed technologies that range from cooking and agricultural implements to a biogas plant and a windmill which can generate up to 800 watts of electricity. Indeed, this year's winners embody the true leadership, humble service, and love for the poor of one of the Philippines' most loved presidents, Ramon Magsaysay.
Each year, Talkback with Tina Palma pays tribute to the men, women, and groups who have been honored with the Ramon Magsaysay Award. And each year, we discover more inspiring stories, more tales of victory over hardship, and more lessons on fighting for what's right and the greater good. Today, we are honored to have with us Harish Hande from India, a Ramon Magsaysay awardee for his passionate efforts to put solar power technology in the hands of the poor. We also have with us Panya Kul from Cambodia. He was given the Ramon Magsaysay Award for his determined and courageous leadership of the sustained campaign for fair and free elections and his fight for democracy. And we have also from the Philippines the Alternative Indigenous Development Foundation Incorporated, or AIDFI, represented by Auke Idzenga. The group is being honored for its collective vision, technological innovations, and partnership practices to make appropriate technologies improve the lives of the poor in Philippine communities. And congratulations. We are honored with your presence.
Thank you very much.
It's an awesome thing that you have done for the groups of people that you have helped. May I begin with you from India. This is solar power technology in a small scale.
Sure.
Yes. Explain to us how the idea came about.
The idea came about around two decades ago in 1991 when I had gone to Dominican Republic and I had seen a lot of poor people using solar, and that's the idea I brought back while doing my master's and PhD thesis and started implementing that in the rural parts of India.
Okay, and this really was meant to be small. This is not a huge kind of a solar power technology that you would be using for industries. It was just to help the poor on a small scale.
Absolutely. It's just following the Gandhian philosophy of decentralization, of how do you decentralize energy utilization and give the empowerment to the poor to have their own energy sources. And what else more than sustainable energy for that empowerment? So it's individual, couple of lights, three lights, four lights, yes.
Okay, and you apply some basic principles of solar power conservation.
Yeah, it's basically a small panel on top of a roof which collects electricity, which actually creates electricity, charges a battery during the daytime, and they can use a couple of lights, charge a mobile phone, a tape recorder, or a radio during the night. It's exactly what they need.
And was this something that had to be put in a community and made the community members the owners of some kind of a cooperative?
No, it's all individual households are owners. So you get financing from the local banks in India for this, but it's individual houses, one by one. It's like democratization of energy in many ways.
Okay, let's stay with that thought, because I wonder why you want to keep it small and not make it big.
Sure.
Okay, what about Panya here? You are from Cambodia, and you have gone through those dark years of the Khmer Rouge, where your parents were victims themselves, and you are now into an NGO that talks about electoral reforms and many, many other things about democracy. What is it all about?
Was during the Peace Paris Agreement 1991, I started to involve with the human rights movement, and the my beginning just tried to make sure to prevent the brutality of human rights abuse, and try to prevent the return to the civil war and the genocide in Cambodia. So I start to engage with the first human rights inside Cambodia. And then in 1993, I also engaged with the election activity with the UNTAC, United Nations Transitional Authority in Cambodia, as a team leader of the voter registration. And then I start to see that it's something very important, election and democracy really, really contribute to the peace and stability in Cambodia. So I'm very interested in that field, and with other leader of civil society, and we formed the CONFREL, is a committee for free and fair election in Cambodia, and this committee for free and fair election in Cambodia just try to make sure that Cambodian as a citizen must have obligation and responsibility, engage and continue to promote democracy, because the UNTAC finished. I mean, the UN mission is finished. Mm-hmm. So as a Cambodian, we must do something, continue that, promote this democracy and free and fair election. Only this means that can make peace and stability in Cambodia.
Okay. And you are Dutch, but you speak fluent Filipino.
Yeah, don't look at my color, more at my heart.
Yeah, you're beginning to sound like somebody from the Philippines, and you've been here to introduce or reintroduce a very traditional kind of a technology. Okay, what is it all about?
Yeah, it's an ancient technology. It's already around here for 230 years, but it was completely overtaken by industrial revolution, and so it never spread through the world. And I came in contact with the technology in 1980s on a university in Holland. And this was still a concrete model made from cement, but it was so amazing that you can pump up water with the energy out of falling water. So it was always in the back of my mind to do something with it. And this time came when I was already 6 years in the Philippines working in socioeconomic programs. And then we said we have to spread this. And it spread from Negros to other parts of the Philippines. The intention was actually only Negros. Then we spread it over other parts in the Philippines. Then we are also in Cambodia. And we do even now technology transfer to Afghanistan and Colombia and Nepal.
Mm-hmm. What I read about your technology, the traditional or historic technology, is that it uses the natural kinetic energy of a moving river or a creek to push it upland.
Yeah.
How is that without using gas and electricity?
Well, everybody knows hydroelectricity. It's the same. Falling water contains energy, and in hydroelectric you use a turbine to convert it into electricity. With the hydraulic ram pump, you convert velocity through the machine, through the pump, in a simple way, and you convert it into pressure, and the pressure pumps up a portion of the water to very great heights. In Cebu, actually, we came up to 200 meters, a vertical height now, 200.
Okay, so both of you are into this kind of, would you say, environment-related kind of technologies.
Right.
And you are in solar power. And before I went on to talk to the other guests, awardees, I asked you, why do you want to keep it small?
See, every individual has his or her own needs. One person would, a street vendor would like one light for 4 hours. The paddy farmer needs one light for 2 hours and one light for 4 hours for his child to study and while cooking. Every individual, especially the poor, are not a monolithic structure. They have their own needs. And especially governments, and especially in the developing part, they design as if everybody uses same amounts of power and design large power plants and coal and nuclear, which according to me is again anti-democratic, because anti-poor, anti-democratic. Mm-hmm. Individual decentralized energy like solar, small wind, small micro hydro actually gives that flexibility of the poor to use how much actually they need and pay how much they can actually afford at that particular point of time. And the beauty of decentralized small is tomorrow, next year I need little more power, I actually buy that extra power and ramp up my quality of life. And that's the beauty of decentralized
energy. And does it actually cut the cost of companies that would have been charging them with other costs other than just the generation cost of the energy itself?
Oh, I mean, the transmission and distribution.
There's no transmission to speak of here. It's just, but wouldn't that, would it have been more economical if you did it on a massive kind of an introduction to a community?
No, because if you look at decentralized energy, it looks at the ecosystem of what a person needs. I mean, for typical example, if I look at somebody doing a sewing machine with solar power, you also look at where the produce is going to be sold. And if a child is getting educated, is there books for the education? So you're looking at a holistic at day one. If you look at, and then you look at the cost of externalities of transmission distribution lines, the coal thermal plants, the safety of nuclear plants. For the governments, it actually works out cheaper, especially for the rural poor.
Yes, and there is a gadget that is installed in the house or is purchased by this homeowner with some particular needs.
Since there's a sense of ownership because people pay for it. It's a solar panel which is actually installed in each person's house. So they are empowered. They become asset creators in many ways,
mm-hmm.
Which is more important.
Like, can you give me in dollars how much it would cost, in U.S. dollars, how much it would cost for an ordinary homeowner?
Typically, when what we do in rural India is average between $150 to $300 for one light to four light systems, cost around $300.
Monthly?
No, one time.
One time installation?
Yeah, right.
Installation. And what happens then if there's no sun?
No, see, that's how
you collect it.
You collect it in a battery. And
yes.
Depending on the criticality of the household, you can design the battery bank in such a way it would, for example, typically we design for 3 days. Like if there is no sunshine for 3 days, you can run your light for 4 hours. Hospital, you design it for 10 days because the criticality of the hospital. So that's the least of the worry.
So how has it transformed all of these 120,000 households that have been beneficiaries or have been customers, in a manner of speaking, of this kind of solar technology?
Transformed in many ways, because if you look at our early history of putting installations from 96, there are kids who today don't believe that electricity can be generated from any other form but solar. And there are people who come to us and say, my daughter does not want to get married because the husband's house has no electricity. Right, so the transformation is just not purely economical, but the emotional transformation is, which is far greater for the nation, rather than just pure economic transformation.
How are you up against the big electrical companies?
I mean, in India, it's...
I mean, are you making a dent insofar as the customer base is concerned?
Not yet, but fortunately, in India, it's a state run and it's very inefficient. So I'm not really against any competition per se. But I think it just, we have proven that this can be done. It also is proven to the government that rather than just relying on imported sources like coal from Indonesia or oil from Saudi Arabia, this is something for it's 500 today in India, 500 million people without electricity after 65 years of independence. Mm-hmm. And we are talking about 8% growth.
And what is your penetration target for the next 5 years?
As an organization, we think we will reach around 200,000 additional clients, that is households. Mm-hmm. But more so after the award, it's not only about our own organization. How do we inspire other youngsters to actually create their mm-hmm. own enterprises?
Yeah. What about in Cambodia? When you got involved in this after going through the experience with your parents and going to Mastera classes, what did you feel or believe about the Cambodian voter? Was he at all interested in an electoral process after so many years of the Khmer Rouge?
I strongly believe that young democracy or fragile democracy like Cambodia is not just about the election, but it's about aggressively campaign, advocate for the free and fair election and better democratic governance. That means not just election time that people have to go to the vote, but after election they should exercise this the power of the vote. In Cambodian language, they use mechachnaut. Mechachnaut means power of the vote, power of the. I mean, as a voter, it's very legitimate, powerful term in Cambodia. If they continue to use that, not just during election time, but after the election, and that can make a difference and can remind the elect official and the government that they should accountable. That's our belief that democracy is something has to benefit to the people.
Yes, maybe what I was trying to ask you is when you got back into this advocacy of yours, did you have a difficulty understanding your Cambodian people as to where they were coming from and where you were now leading them towards? Was there a difficulty in trying to introduce them or reintroduce to them the idea of an election process?
I think
or even a democratic environment.
Yes, very, very yeah. difficult. Since the beginning, when we introduced the first stage is a human rights, and a lot of negative reaction from the government and the government supporter. They say that human rights is just something defend the criminal person and bandit. It's not about dignity. So we try to integrate human rights, civil, political rights. They are also in our culture value. Religious value, traditional mm-hmm. value, so make people easy to understand, to catch what is some core value related to human rights. Democracy also, election also, is not easy for Cambodia. Cambodia mm-hmm. sometimes see that election is just produce a new elite, mm-hmm. try to,
yes.
to, you know, because we in have some what we call the joke, that when they get elected, they just close the door. And they put the dog to keep guard, not allow people access
yes.
to meet with this elect official. So we need to educate people why should proceed with this kind of bad practice. We should change our attitude, should have some exercise.
And are you
power.
Feeling good about what you have seen so far in what your efforts have yielded?
I think people now start aware that they should hold the elect official accountable to what they promise, what they perform, because mm-hmm. the elect official, they must fulfill their promise and effectively perform and respond to the constituency and the citizens. So step by step, I think the voters see, remind them that they are not ordinary citizens, they are the voter. That means yeah. own all the power. Remind them in Cambodian language is a mechachnaut.
Okay. When we return, we'll know more about the triumphs and trials of this year's Ramon Magsaysay awardees, and you are watching Talkback.